Mesquite High School in our team.
Okay. Let me find out which council member is in charge, okay. And I'll put you in charge.
You don't? All right.
I'm checking.
Well, I gotta check in too, but I'm not sure who's checking.
It was supposed to be Wendy, but I just asked.
Vice Mayor Taylor.
Oh.
Call him Jared. He's coming up. He's
one who's doing the award right there.
Yes. And he's one who's going to award it. You guys are good to go, but I'm sure he'd love to ask you a question. Oh, okay. And congratulations.
There's David Wright. I'm supposed to be giving the invocation tonight.
Wonderful.
Who am I supposed to be checking in? Of course, should I just be saying.
So, I just think it'll be six. Hey, Jim.
How you doing? I'm David Wright. I'm here for the invocation.
David, what?
So, do you want this way?
I think, like,
we will make this the 30-second warning to start our meeting this evening. Thank you. We'd like to welcome you to the January 5th, 2017 Town Council meeting, our first one of the year, and we are thrilled to be starting the year with such a great group here tonight. We will call this meeting to order at 6:31 p.m., and we have several proclamations and presentations this evening, all of which I am absolutely thrilled about, so I will be anxiously engaged in all of this tonight, and we appreciate your attendance, your commitment to community, and the fact that you would all take time out of your evening today to come here and to share a few minutes with us. At this time, we will look to Councilmember Canlin for agenda item one. That's a proclamation declaring January 5th, 2017 as Gina Johnson and Sharing Down Syndrome Arizona Recognition Day. After that, we will have Vice Mayor for at least the rest of this meeting, Vice Mayor Jared Taylor. That wasn't an inside joke. Every January, we redo the Vice Mayor assignment, and so this is actually Vice Mayor Taylor's last council meeting as the Vice Mayor. He'll go back to a lowly council member at that point, which is, we joke, it's the same pay and less meetings, so we're good with that. He will take care of the Mesquite High School Wildcat Marching Band State Champions, which I think we have a few in the room today, and then finally, Councilmember Jordan Ray will have a special recognition for Dan Reynolds, our fire captain, as he retires with 24 years of service to the town of Gilbert. So pretty remarkable, and all three great opportunities for us to pay thanks in our community. So with that, Councilmember Canlin.
Thank you, Mayor. If I could have Jenna come up.
David, look.
Good, like.
Usually we read these, but I'm going to go a little off script today and just talk for a second. I met Jenna 13 years ago at church, and I was immediately intrigued by what she did because of this young man right here, who we fight and wrestle, and he wins all the time. But they're my good friends. And this is my last council meeting tonight, which I've been very grateful for, and I asked to have this proclamation placed here. But let me tell you a little bit about Jenna and sharing Down syndrome, if I can. It's been 25 years here in Gilbert that she has operated sharing Down syndrome. And what you won't know about Jenna is she tries to visit every mother and father who are expecting a young child with Down syndrome. And so she makes it to the hospital. She gives all of her time and her energy, no pay, and she's just full of love. And if you know Jenna, like most of you know Jenna, you can't help but feel the love that she has for not only these sweet kids that are here tonight and my friend David, but for everybody.
His name is Troy now.
Oh, his name is Troy. So with that, can you hear me? With that, just read a little bit from this proclamation. Whereas Gina Johnson, a proud mother of 7 children, including David, who has Down syndrome, recognized the need to have Down syndrome support group in Gilbert. Her advocacy journey led her to connect with other families faced with the same challenges, and Sharing Down Syndrome Arizona was founded by Jenna Johnson in 1991. Its mission is to enhance and provide quality of life through education, empowerment, to offer hope to individuals who have Down syndrome, reach their potential, and Sharing Down Syndrome Arizona is the champion of all people who have Down syndrome and helps promote positive acceptance and understanding of each life. So now, therefore, I'm speaking on behalf of Mayor Daniels. We proclaim January 5th, 2017 as Jenna Johnson and Sharing Down Syndrome Arizona Recognition Day. And might I add that her husband, Kurt, is here, and he's done a tremendous amount for this organization as well, and we'd like to recognize him and have him come forward as well.
I'm usually not speechless, but my heart is humbled. I love these children. When David was born, I love you too, chatty boy. Oh my gosh, you gotta hug all these cute kids.
I love you.
I love you. Oh, I didn't even see you there, Hannah. Oh my gosh, Carol brought you? Oh my gosh. David, all of our children change our lives. When I had David, I fell apart because I thought my world was coming crashing down around me, but I didn't know it was just beginning. I also have to tell you how grateful I am for all of my 7 children. They have carried me and helped me, and you think you're going to be a super mom, and sometimes you are and sometimes you're not, but they love you anyway. But most of all, I'd like to tell you, dear parents, how much I love you and your children. Oh my gosh, look at these babies. And I'd like to express my love and gratitude to our Father in Heaven, who truly loves these children. I feel like the greatest gift I was ever given was a baby who I cried and cried when he was born. I love you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Councilmember Candlin, for bringing that proclamation forward. We're so grateful for each of you to be here. We're going to move to another recognition of some wonderful young people as well. in a different space part of Gilbert here. So I'd like to invite forward the Mesquite High School Marching Band and their leadership. They could come forward. Let's give them a big hand. Thank you. And then, are you the drum major? All right, you stand by me. Okay, these individuals have done something very special, and Mayor, we're pleased to recognize them. But before we do that, I'd like you to introduce your team here with us, will you? Introduce yourself, and then talk a little bit about what you've done, and then let's introduce your team that you brought here with you tonight.
I am Jason. I am the drum major as well as the band council president for the Wildcat Marching Band. This year was a really great year. We have a new director in Mr. Willers, and we went to how many competitions? Seven or something like that. And we managed to take first at all of them, and out of 35 captions, we took 32. And this being my senior year, I couldn't be prouder and more thankful to this band for sending us seniors off with a nice salute.
My name is Kimberlyn Sanchez. I play the flute. I am council treasurer as well as our flute soloist.
My name is Julia Bragelman. I was the trumpet section leader, and I'm also the band council vice president.
My name is John Lee, and I'm the section leader for the low brass. I play the tenor sax, and I'm the secretary for the band council.
And I am David Willers. I'm the new director, as Jason mentioned, over at Mesquite High School. It's been just an incredible honor to step into a program with such highly motivated students, as you see before you, and to continue to keep this excellence. This is our third year running that we've taken home the Division III state title, and it's a complete honor to represent Gilbert and represent this community as well as we have, and wonderful people in front of you. So thank you so much.
Mayor, you know that we have a very rich history of arts in Gilbert, and especially music. I went to a school across town and was always envious of the music programs in Gilbert, and you're carrying that heritage on very proudly for us, and we compliment you. We'd like to give you the certificate of recognition. Let me just read a little bit about this recognition for you. Mesquite High School Wildcat Marching Band. For a season of outstanding performances, including a third consecutive Arizona Band and Orchestra Directors Association Division III State Championship title, and a second consecutive Arizona Marching Band Association AA Class Championship. In addition, we would like to recognize the band directors, band staff, band council, band instructors, and the Wildcat Marching Band members for earning several additional captain awards in the areas of music, visual, general effects, and percussion, while winning numerous other awards at other competitions this year. And there's a couple of more things there. It's signed Mayor Jen Daniels, dated January 5th. Now, I didn't see a recognition for parents. Maybe I skipped it here, but we know that the parents had a huge part in helping raise money and getting you the private lessons and all those things. So for the parents and this wonderful state championship marching band, let's give them another big round of applause. So we're going to give the certificate of recognition to the drum major here, and then Jessica here will take a few pictures here. Mayor, anything you'd like to add to the marching band?
No, but thank you. Thank your teachers. You just started back to school today. You seniors have one semester left of school, so hang in there. And thank you. We actually thought that you were one of the students, so that's incredible. You're doing a great job. Keep up the great work, and we'll be cheering you on next year as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations.
K
Captain Reynolds, come on up. And have the firefighters, if they'll come up as well. That's you guys in the blue shirts. Come on up. I know. This is the second month in a row that I've got to say goodbye to one of our firefighters who've done such a great job. And, you know, firefighters kind of have two families, right? They have the family that they're at home with, they do so much with, and then they have those who they serve with. In classic Dan Reynolds fashion, he didn't really invite his family to come tonight. And not because he doesn't like them, I'm going to tell a story about that in a minute, but because it's Dan Reynolds. And he just, hey, it's not that big of a deal, I'm just retired. It's only 24 years that I have been serving as a firefighter. We have a great certificate of appreciation, as Councilmember Candlin did. I'm going to set it aside, and I'm going to tell a couple stories about Dan. So where I live, we have about 10 stations in Gilbert, fire stations. The best one is Station 2. I apologize for those behind me, but Station 2 is right by my house. And so that's what we call our hometown station. After I got put on council, I started seeing Dan all over the place. He was at the school, he was at church activities, he was at this and that, because he always would volunteer and the fire department would generally come. Sometimes they wouldn't show up because they got a call, or they would leave early with their sirens going, which always made the kids happy to see that. But a couple stories. One of the first times I spent way more time with Dan than I wanted to was at a Cub Scout event. And the fire department came and they were doing a water demonstration with them, and it seemed like it was 130 degrees outside, and maybe it was. And I kept telling Dan, like, hey, shut the pump down, let's go. I was one of the leaders, I was ready to go. And Dan said, hey, kids are having fun, we're gonna let them keep playing. And he must have spent hours there. And all the leaders wanted to leave, and the fire department said, no, the kids are having a good time, we'll just stay. Obviously, Dan learned a number of things as a firefighter, including, you know, how to strap maybe people to him to help get out of a fire. And I say that because the other night I came down to downtown Gilbert at the water tower, and I look over and Dan's got grandkids strapped to the front of him, strapped to the back of him, all because a daughter got married, needed some time away with her husband, and so he had the grandkids. And I don't know how many were strapped to him, but there were a lot. And he had them all night long, getting on and off the carriage, all over the place. But the story that probably impacted me the most was when I was a relatively new council member. We had a really big vote coming up, and we thought it was probably the biggest vote that we'd had at the time, and I think maybe it was. Lots of controversy, and so Dan, Captain Reynolds, invited me to the fire station and said, hey, let's talk about this a little bit. Let me give you my opinion on what you guys are gonna be voting on. And so I went down there, and Dan said, you know, tell me your thoughts, and so I spent quite a while talking to him and explaining what I thought about certain things and why I thought we should vote a certain way. And he was patient for a while, and he finally got his turn to speak. And he was kind of making his point, and he, I'm sure, had an excellent point to make, and it was contrary to my opinion. And right when he gets to the point of really telling me what he thinks in a very kind way, the siren goes off at the station. And as soon as it goes off, he looks at me and says, I gotta go. I don't know if it was a cat stuck in a tree or if it was someone who had died at a car accident, but to Dan, it didn't matter. The siren went off and he left. And so, I say thank you. I didn't think this would happen, Dan. I say thank you to Dan and to all of our firefighters. We often say, hey, when I grew up, I want to be a firefighter. To me, it's more like I want to be like Dan Reynolds. Anything you want to say, Captain Reynolds?
First of all, you got an awesome memory. Secondly, it's a privilege that you were able to present, because some of the things he talked about were so true, and I got to meet him at one of the events for the very first time, and the feeling I had for him then is the same as I have today, is my gut instincts were right, that he's a person who cares about this community, and he makes good decisions, and he's level-headed. And for that, I say thank you, and I appreciate that. So I want to say thanks to the town. I've been fortunate to work here, and it's also the place where I live. And some people don't want that situation, but I did, and I love it. And it's got its pros and cons, but a lot more pros. But I've been extremely grateful for this opportunity. This town is awesome. I want to say thanks to the current council members and mayor and the people that went before us, because they mapped something out special here, and I love it, especially downtown, which is where my grandkids were strapped to me. And I lost the binky that night, so that didn't go so good. But thank you very much. Appreciate it.
So Sunday morning at 7 a.m., Captain Reynolds is done. So if you need it, great treatment before he's done, sometime between Saturday morning at 7 and Sunday morning at 7, he'll be at Station 1. So if you're down by the mall area and need help, he's there. And then after that, if you ever need help with your smoke detectors, he's the guy to call. So does everyone want to come in for one quick picture?
That concludes the proclamations and presentations portion of our council meeting this evening. We will take a 9-minute recess until 7 p.m. where we start the business of our meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll make this the 30-second warning to restart our meeting tonight. As we get started on this portion of our meeting, the business portion of our meeting this evening, I'd just like to point your attention to the slides, slide that's up right now. It's fine. We do have some upcoming community events, including our digital state of the town, which will be premiering, and I do say that with great enthusiasm, premiering on January 24th at Harkins Movie Theater. We are encouraging people to go online. It is a free event, but we would like people to register. We need headcounts because we will be in a theater. And so we invite the community to that event, our annual digital state of the town. We also have next Thursday evening right here in council chambers at 7 p.m. the inauguration. We're also calling it the swearing in. It sounds too presidential, I think, when we call it the inauguration. But the swearing in of two council members, Councilmember-elect Scott Anderson, Vice Mayor slash Council Member Jared Taylor, and also myself as mayor. So we're looking forward to that next Thursday evening at 7 in this room. And there is an East Valley Breakfast with the Governor January 12th at 7:30. Oh, did it change to 8:30?
6:30
a.m.
Speaks at 7.
Okay, bright and early. Thank you for noting that. And our combined meeting, our annual combined meeting with the Gilbert Chamber, which is also a public meeting that you all are all invited to at 7:30 a.m. the morning of the digital state of the town. So we'll start that day early and end it on a good note as well. So we appreciate everyone's activity and commitment to Gilbert. We cannot do it without the support of our residents, one of whom is here today to help us. And so I look to Councilmember Bridget Peterson to assist. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Daniels. I was given the task of introducing the scouts tonight, but seeing none in the audience, I went back and drafted Zoe from the Mayor's Youth Advisory Council. She's going to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the
Zoe, would you like to introduce yourself real quick? Your full name and where you go.
My name's Zoe Biggs, and I go to Gilbert High School, and I'm in 11th grade. So,
thank you, Zoe. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Zoe. Zoe is one of 36 young people in our Mayor's Youth Advisory Committee. There's a few others that are here tonight. We appreciate your attendance. It is required that they attend one council meeting, but I've heard some of them have come to multiple already. They must be very enthusiastic about town council, so thank you. We'd like to invite Pastor David Wright of LifeLink Church to the podium to offer the invocation for us this evening. Pastor Wright, thank you for being here.
Mayor and Council, men and women, thank you so much for your service. I was just thinking as I was watching you do all the proclamations and things, how involved your lives are with the everyday warp and woof of life and just the people that call Gilbert home. It's a privilege to pastor in this great area, and thank you for facilitating and cherishing faith. It's a joy to serve here. So I appreciate what you do, the 250,000 people that call Gilbert home, the complexities that serve with it, trying to figure out and sort through all the agendas. I know your world is complex. The environment we live in is filled with tension. But we appreciate, as the people that you serve, what you do. But don't take it for granted. We really do appreciate it. So with that, I'd like to offer the invocation. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you as men and women who are privileged to serve in this season, this era of Earth's history. We acknowledge you, Almighty God, in your place as our sovereign creator. We facilitate you in the workings of our spirit, our soul, and mind, and ask that tonight you would give these men and women wisdom that flows from heaven to align their choices and decisions that they make to better and facilitate the well-being of our town. We thank you in advance for all of this. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor. At this time, the clerk will now conduct the roll call.
Mayor Jen Daniels.
Here.
Vice Mayor Jared Taylor.
Here.
Councilmember James Canlin.
Present.
Councilmember Eddie Cook.
Here.
Councilmember Victor Peterson.
Here.
Councilmember Bridget Peterson.
Here.
Councilmember Jordan Ray.
Here.
A quorum is present.
Thank you, Lisa. At this time of the agenda, it's communications from citizens, and I look to Vice Mayor Taylor to assist us. Do we have any requests to speak?
Mayor, we have three tonight. I'd like to first call forward Mr. John Rice. Justin, I apologize. Mr. Rice, yes, if you could come over here to the podium. There's a microphone there. There'll be lights in front of you. That'll give you your three-minute cues. If you could state your name and location of residence, and we're thankful that you're here tonight.
Sure. Thank you for listening. I appreciate it. So my name is Justin Rice. I live in the La Aldea community, which is located on Power and Guadalupe. So I wanted to bring to your attention a issue that we have in our community as well as neighboring communities of mosquitoes. And it was my understanding that the town has decided not to spray, particularly in certain areas anymore. Due to that, we have noticed this year there's been a large population of mosquitoes. We have a playground. We have a green belt that doesn't have any standing water in the green belt. But because it's there, I believe it attracts more. And we had a number of kids with where we took pictures where their the bites are all over their legs, their arms. We have a lot of families in the community, so lots of kids at play, and it's pretty impactful, I'll say. So I'm hoping to bring this to your attention in hopes that we could bring back the spraying since we've seen a significant increase in bites.
Mayor?
Thank you.
Can I?
Our ability to comment is limited at this time, but we can absolutely direct staff to have a conversation with
Vector Control,
which
Maricopa
is
Maricopa County.
Yes. Thank you.
Great. I appreciate that.
Who from staff can we point him to talk out in the hall maybe and give the explanation?
Is Jessica here? Jessica's done a tremendous job. Oh, David. David's your man.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
Thank you, Justin. Appreciate you being here tonight.
Thank you. One last thing, if I may. If there was a contact, we seem to have quite a safety issue in our community with parking. We don't have any parking spaces. It's a shared driveway issue. All the parking spaces get filled. There's maybe about 80 to 100 spaces for 352 homes. So if I could just have a contact for somebody that could evaluate, they're parking in fire lanes, and I'd hate to have a fire truck have to come through there.
I see Commander Bryce in the back raising his hand. That sounds like a public safety issue that we'd want to address. So maybe you could both provide him with your contact information, and I'm sure we can get both those issues addressed. Thank you.
Thank you so much to all of you.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Next, we'd like to invite Pat Hickman forward. Mr. Hickman, thank you for being here tonight. If you'll state your name, location of residence, and lights in front of you and the podium, we'll give you your three-minute cues.
Thanks. Thank you. My name is Pat Hickman. I live in Trilogy in Gilbert, which is at the corner of Queen Creek and Power Road. I did address the council in your last meeting on December 1st of last year about this is going to be a mosquito evening, obviously, about the problem that we have, and presented a petition with almost 200 signatures signed about the issue. At that time, it was my understanding that this was going to be an item on the agenda, and I do not see it on the agenda for this meeting, and maybe I'm not aware of exactly where that is, but I would like to know what the status of that request. The request was for additional maintenance. To be quite honest, we still have mosquitoes even after the freeze, even after the cold weather, even after. When it warms up, if we don't get this under control by March, it's going to be a mess. It's going to be even worse. They're just spreading. They're spreading. Something needs to be done about Sunoke Wash immediately. But I'm just wondering, it was the agenda item, I'm just wondering where that stands and what the status is.
It is not an agenda item on tonight's agenda. However, we will have staff follow up with you. I know that there's been a couple emails. I think that one of those emails was to you about the update, but I'll clarify because I saw a copy of one. And so I'll ask, actually, I'll look to Mark Skisipic here, assistant town manager, to be the point person for you.
Yes, because I did not receive, well, I didn't receive an email.
Okay.
That I'm aware of, so.
Thank you.
Anyway, I can't stress this enough. This is going to be unacceptable to go through another summer. Much like the gentleman before me, it's intolerable. You can't go outside. So this is unacceptable. This has to be taken care of somehow. Thank you.
Thank you, Pat. Mayor, last we would like to invite Georgia Schilling forward. Is Ms. Schilling here? Thank you for being here tonight. The podium in front of you have the lights for 3 minutes. If you'll state your name, locations of residence, and we appreciate you being here.
My name is Georgia Schilling, and I also live at Trilogy at Power Ranch. And I moved here at the end of August, and I expected to have a lifetime of wonderful activities in my backyard. I have lot 2035 at Trilogy at Power Ranch. It's the last lot. It backs up to the Sunoke Wash. I cannot use my backyard even through the first week in December because the mosquitoes are out of control. On a number of occasions, I've contacted the mayor once, I've contacted Patty Jordan, I've contacted Vector Control more than once, and they have not been able to control the mosquitoes at all. I believe that they do not have the adequate means to do that. I cannot tell when they treat the water and when they don't. There is no difference in the impact of the mosquitoes, none whatsoever. The wash is standing water nearly all the time. I did research on the town site about the wash. The wash is incomplete. It has never been completed. In 2008, I understand that people were congratulating themselves that the wash was completed and done under budget. Well, the reason it probably was done under budget is because it's not complete. The sides have no rocks to hold the soil. I believe some of the soils, if you look at the wash, have fallen in. They've created dams along the basin of the wash. You can see them, they're clearly visible. So there's no flow in the water, or very little flow. So we have erosion. Also, there's no sub-channel in that section. Queen Creek has rocks along the side of the channel. It has a sub-channel. Chandler has a sub-channel. We do not have a sub-channel. So I want to know, is that ever going to be completed and corrected the way it should be so we do not have a problem? You can continue to do all kinds of larvicides and all of those things. They haven't worked so far. At all. So you're going to be treating symptoms, which is ineffective and a failure, or you can complete the wash and help us to enjoy our lives. We spent years getting to the point where we could retire and enjoy ourselves, and we can't. Also, two people in Trilogy have documented West Nile virus, and I expect that more people will. I understand Vector Control recently made some comments to Patty Jordan, who I spoke or emailed with, that, well, we haven't caught any West Nile virus mosquitoes. The problem is not only the West Nile virus, but it's also the amount of mosquitoes that are present. One more example. Just going from my garage to take the garbage cans out and come back in through the garage hurrying, I've gotten bitten no less than 6 times in that quick trip. So please get the wash fixed. You got thousands of people outside of Trilogy as well that are affected by this. It's not right. It's non-functional. Thank you.
Thank you. Mayor, that's all that we have for requests to speak tonight.
Thank you, and thank you to all our residents who are present this evening to assist us. We greatly appreciate your feedback. That leads us to the consent calendar on our agenda this evening, and I look to Vice Mayor Taylor to assist us with consent.
Mayor, thank you. For the consent agenda, item 4A has been requested to be discussed by Councilmember Victor Peterson. As noted on the dais, item number 8 is moved to the January 26th meeting. And otherwise, I would like to move items 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10, 11, and 12.
Second.
Sorry, they were a little fast on the second there, Mayor.
Sorry about that.
If I may pull forward number 15, which is a board and commission item, and move that we appoint as 3 regular members to the Town of Gilbert, Arizona Water Resources Municipal Property Corporation with a term beginning January 12, 2017 and ending January 11th, 2020. Kevin Boudreau, Noah Munt, and John Dalen Wilcock.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote. That motion passes with a 7-0 vote. Thank you. That moves us to agenda item 4A. Councilmember Victor Peterson.
Mayor, thank you. I hope my comment will be understood as it's intended, which is simply to explain my vote and not as an attempt to score political points. Before the original agreement with St. Xavier was approved, Vice Mayor Taylor and I expressed concern about the ability of that agreement to fully protect the taxpayers from financial risk. Because I continue to hold that concern related to that agreement, I think this settlement is as good as we can do to protect the taxpayers at this point. I will say I believe this council is united in its determination to make the best of a disappointing situation. And to that end, we will continue to pursue other users to fill this facility. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Councilmember Peterson. I would definitely agree with the statement that you've made, that we are all committed to making this facility a asset to the community. And so thank you for that statement. We have would you like to make a motion on that, Councilmember Peterson?
Sure. I move to approve item 4A as presented.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Do any other council members wish to comment at this time? Sorry, I didn't want to. All right. Motion and a second. Please vote. That motion carries with a 7-0 vote. This moves us to our public hearing items on our agenda tonight. Items will be heard at one public hearing, at which time anyone wishing to comment on a public hearing item may do so. Comments will be heard from those in support of or in opposition to an item. And we have 2 public hearing items, a liquor license, item 13, and item 14 has actually been moved to the January 26th council meeting. So we have essentially 1 public hearing item tonight. Does any council member wish to comment?
Mayor,
I would like to open the public hearing then on agenda item 13.
Mayor, thank you. This is a little different of a liquor license in terms of sampling. We've seen this before. Not going to extend this, but love to keep our supermarkets family friendly, so I'll not be voting in support of this tonight.
Thank you. Any other comments from council? I will close the public hearing on agenda item 13 and entertain a motion.
Mayor, I ask that we move to approve agenda item 13.
Second.
Motion and a second. Please vote. That motion carries with a 5-2 vote. Thank you. That concludes the public hearing items for the tonight's, and it moves us to administrative items. Since we've already taken care of agenda item 15, that brings us to agenda item 16 tonight. And I believe we have a staff presentation on agenda item 16. Hawken? Thank you.
Mayor, council members, this item was at the request of several council members. The staff was requested to put this on. I do have a few slides. This is your discussion to have, and so that's if you want to see them, we're happy to show you what we've got. They're very brief and factual. So
because this is the beginning part of a discussion, no action will actually be taken on this agenda item tonight. This is really the beginning of a conversation that may or may not result in an ordinance change for the town of Gilbert. So I do think that from a public education perspective, a couple of slides would be helpful. And then perhaps we can look to, I think Councilmember Cook, you were the lead on this. If you wouldn't mind sort of taking the reins from there, that'd be great.
All right, so again, what was requested of staff was to bring forward the beginning of modifying the tax code for specifically for the bed tax from 3.0% to 2.8%. As the current tax code is written, it's collected from the hotels. The hotels pass that tax along to their occupiers. It's in addition to the privilege tax of 1.5%. Again, some factual information. How we compare to some of the cities and municipalities around us, where they were in 2010, where they are in 2016. These are the payers of the tax are the hotels. They collect the equivalent amount from their the people that are, frequent those hotels. All this plays into those, a third of those funds are required to be spent on tourism activities. Gilbert allocates more than that minimum required amount. The tourism dollars spent are meant to increase these three metrics used by the hotel industry, average daily rate and then RevPAR. Projections in FY16, if this change were to have occurred in that fiscal year, it would have equated just under $38,000. We anticipate if this change were to have been in effect the entire fiscal year 17, about $42,000-$43,000, and moving forward in fiscal year 18, about a $50,000 a year impact. As we saw on the previous slide over here, there's four hotels in the pipeline, so that number, as we add hotels, the amount collected would decrease. Overall, it would increase as we have more hotels. What do these these dollars do? I jumped ahead a little bit here. One third of this is required to go to tourism activities. The remaining monies go into the general fund. The impact for this reduction would be an impact on tourism activities. Economic development has implemented a five-year strategic plan based on the 3%. This would change some of those plans, not overly significantly, but it would have an impact. As a technicality, today the tax law is one-third of these dollars are required to go towards tourism. Any increase in the future, 100% of the increase is required to go to tourism. So if we were to reduce it and then increase it at some point in the future, there would be less flexibility there. Next steps again tonight is for council to decide whether or not to direct staff to begin this 60-day process of notifying the taxpayer with a public notice and set a public hearing 60 days from today. And that's what I have.
So. Thank you, Hawken. Excuse me, are there any questions from any council member to Hawken?
Hawken, can you show the slide that had all of the municipalities?
Mayor, can I ask a question of staff on this one? Do we know why Chandler and AJ aren't at 3%?
Mayor, and I do not have the answer to that question at this time. I can look into that and we can follow up. I don't know the history of their tax code at this point, but we can find the answer for you.
Mayor, I think it'd be great for us to have a competitive advantage in this area over at least Chandler. I guess we still wouldn't be beating out Apache Junction. I'm not sure, you know, due to the location, if it's a real competitor for us or not. But I think 2.8 would be great. At the end of the day, I think if you want something more, tax it less. And so I think this is a great idea.
Thank you. Councilmember Cook.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. This topic, you know, we've had this discussion about this topic a few times over the last, you know, 5 to 6 years, and I think, you know, as we've learned over the number of wonderful years of hotels now coming into Gilbert, and obviously the pot of money that's collected from that 3% continues to grow. So we're not by any means looking at, even if this change were to happen, that it's not going to be any significant impact to the collection of what the future is going to bring. One of the reasons why I wanted to bring this up again has been, as you remember, not too long ago, that we did make a change to our tax code to reduce four categories of public sales tax, which was great that we had a unanimous decision from the council to move forward with that. And I look at this as being something similar, because we're now going to potentially tweak, make a little adjustment in potentially lowering this from 3 to 2.8. My reason really has been more of the competitive advantage, as Councilmember Peterson indicated, that I do like competition. I do like being able to say that we're going to add more beds, and we don't necessarily need to have that amount of additional tax dollars going into that pot of money. And I'm not saying we want to grow any more of government, but I believe from a competitive advantage, even though we've had the discussion that lowering the bed tax may not make a user pick a particular hotel. But again, I think from our bragging rights of having the lowest tax burden here in the region, that's the reason why I decided to bring this back up. And I think that it's about the right, you know, time to move forward in looking at that.
If I could just ask a question, Councilmember Cook, since I understand that you've taken the lead, have you had any discussions with any of our hotel owners or operators about their feelings on this? I would imagine that would be part of our stakeholder process as well, but just curious.
Yeah, so I've been working with staff. You know, in fact, Kelly and I have had this discussion probably 3 or 4 months ago, and I've asked staff to, again, revisit this coming fiscal year, you know, what are some of the other tweaks we can do within the organization that wouldn't hurt our business as relates to reducing our taxes to our tax base here in Gilbert. And we pretty much got the same answer, that the hotel community would actually like us to increase the bed tax, so that we could take those additional dollars to, you know, obviously use for advertisement of their businesses as relates to tourism. So that was the feedback that I got, was that they'd rather have it go the other direction versus going down.
Thank you for that feedback. Any other questions or comments from council? Vice Mayor Taylor.
Mayor, I don't know if Councilmember Cook or staff has done the numbers on what the fiscal impact would be if we went to 2.8. Did I miss it?
It's $50,000.
$50,000 annually?
Yes, okay. Annually. And again, as it relates to, you'll also see in a slide, they anticipate 4 new hotels coming into the market. So again, that pot of money will obviously exceed the $50,000. So again, as it relates to, I'm not saying we're looking for a net here, but again, I think we're able to tweak this just a little bit to bring that down.
Thank you.
Yeah, Councilmember Peterson.
I just want to comment that just because you lower the rate, tax rate, doesn't mean the revenues will necessarily decrease. And I think Councilmember Cook's sort of alluding to that, but the basic economic principle is that people consume more at lower prices than they do at higher prices. There are a number of documented cases where the federal government actually lowered the income tax rate and income tax revenues actually increased. So again, economic activity is higher at lower tax rates. And so a lot of times you'll see an offset and sometimes even an increase as a result of cutting taxes. So I know there's lots of different opinions on that, and you'll have different economists say different things, but I think this is a great idea. So just want to push that a little bit.
Thank you, Councilmember Peterson. I did receive feedback today. The Chamber of Commerce has not yet had a chance and opportunity to review this and will wait until stakeholder process to contribute. I know that they have a tourism effort themselves, and I just received that sort of anecdotal feedback this morning. I look at Dan Henderson, who administers our tourism program through the Office of Economic Development. And Dan, I wonder if you couldn't come to the podium for just a second to touch on the five-year plan. Hawken mentioned that if we do move forward with this, let's say that revenues decrease by $50,000 as anticipated, even though we recognize that that's a guess, right? We're forecasting, but not educated forecast, but not necessarily, you know, set in stone. Can you touch on how our plans as a community, we've adopted a tourism plan, can you touch on how those plans may change or be altered in order to accommodate this?
Sure. Thank you, Mayor, members of council. My name is Dan Henderson. I serve as your Economic Development Director. The question about the five-year strategic plan related to tourism is really based on campaigns and other components that are designed to increase revenues related to bed tax. The focus of the five-year strategic plan in tourism in Gilbert is really focused on business travelers. So it's not a, there are many different strategies deployed for tourism. Some have specific amenities, some have specific assets. Our strategic plan is really focused on connecting those travelers that come into the community or come into the area, the trade area, with things to do. And the emphasis there is to increase awareness of the community. And so in my humble opinion, in terms of the impact, while I think it was stated perfectly by the various council members, with the advent of new hotels, the revenues are likely to increase overall, and our focus will remain on the connectivity of those travelers coming into the market. As a result, I think that without conferring with the hotels and sort of speaking on my own specifically to the five-year strategic plan, I believe the impact of lowering the rate will be minimal.
Thank you, Dan, for that contribution to our discussion today. With that, barring any other comments from council, I think we can entertain a motion.
So we're basically going to make a motion that we give direction for the for staff to make a correction, or I shouldn't say a correction, a change to that bed tax. Is that what you're asking for? Because I know this was just more direction.
The motion is to begin the 60-day public process.
Okay, I would like to make a motion that we begin that 60-day process, that we would change the our ordinance to reflect that the bed tax go from 3% to 2.8%.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote. That motion carries with a 7-0 vote. Thank you. That brings us to agenda item 17 on our council agenda, boards, commissions, and committee reports. I'm not anticipating a lot tonight. It's, you know, Christmas holiday in between our last meeting and now, so not too much has gone on. Anyone? James, you look anxious. Okay. Vice Mayor Taylor.
Mayor, not specific to any one of these, but those individuals who might be following the meeting, we would just encourage all residents to go to the gilbertaz.gov homepage and look for an opportunity to put your email on and get on the list, because when openings come up on these boards and commissions, you'll get notified that there's an open seat. And we would love to have everyone who's interested in serving in these and feels that they have something to offer to apply and be part of the process. There's wonderful ways that you can contribute to our town, and we would just encourage you to look through the list, see what you like. May not get picked the first time, but we'd love to have you on serve on the board and commission or a committee at some point, and would just invite everyone who's interested to do that.
Thank you, Vice Mayor Taylor. And I look to, I think, Councilmember Bridget Peterson. I guess we'll do that in current events. Huh? We have no policy items tonight, and I had no future meeting agenda item requests either. So that moves us to communications, a report from our town manager on current events.
Thank you, Mayor. Members of the council, nothing tonight.
Thank you. Report from council. Councilmember Bridget Peterson, yes.
Mayor, I know that we'll cover this a little bit more next week, but I wanted to say thank you to Councilmember James Candland for his time on the council, since this is officially the last time that he'll sit with us on the dais before the official swearing in next Thursday evening. But I wanted to say that it's been a pleasure working with you. You have gone above and beyond, in my opinion, for somebody that was appointed to this position. You have stepped up to the plate better than people that have been elected to this position have over the time that you have filled it. So I wanted to thank you for that, and I appreciate your time and your effort, and I appreciate being your new friend.
Thank you.
Councilmember Peterson.
Mayor, on a similar note, I just want to thank Councilmember James Candland for being willing to get outvoted with me a few times. Thank you, James.
It's been a pleasure.
All right, and I have already reported on our current events, but I would like to say Happy New Year to all of the residents in Gilbert, and meeting adjourned. Thank you.